systems people were used to be called, these days they're called quality assurance engineers. This is their job. They want to make sure that the system works properly. Now, the test samples have to be executed through the system, and you have to make sure that the system performs properly when it executes the test samples. An additional burden with the large-scale enterprise systems is their scalability. These are systems that are designed to support not hundreds of users, not thousands of users, but tens of thousands, in some cases hundreds of thousands of simultaneous users. A system that can perform perfectly fine when a couple of hundred users log in may collapse when 20,000 users log in. Now, luckily for us, these days there are automated tools to do this. So, it's possible, and these are special programs designed to test the scalability of the system. So, you cannot really test the system with 20,000 users because it's just not feasible. Those people are doing other things. So, it has to be done programmatically. And those programs exist, and by now, this is fairly well developed. This is not where the challenge is. A more significant challenge is to make sure that the users are capable of properly navigating through the system and doing the tasks that they have to do in the course of their daily activities well. Now, this is evaluated by testing the system involving some of the end users who are given business scenarios. In some cases, it would be similar to what you get in some of the stages of your project. So there would be a textual description, what those end users have to do after those users are trained on the system. And they will have to sit down and go step by step and verify that they indeed can accomplish all the steps and how long it takes. So this is a different kind of test. So this is not high volume. This is rather business scenario testing. And you are trying also to test the system on the margins, checking more exotic capabilities of the system to make sure that everything works. Because this is where most likely problems will be. So the regular steps are typically okay, but there you really have to focus on the scalability. And it's, as far as the business scenario testing is concerned, it's really some of those highly unusual cases where the system may run into problems. So what about training? The challenge with training, actually there are several challenges with training. One challenge is timing. So if you are deploying a very large system in an organization, and you know that you have to train the end users, it's important to decide when you're going to train the users. Why is it a challenge? What do you think? Why is it a challenge to decide when? What's the big deal? So let's see what happens. You have to run an organization, a large system is going to be deployed, so you have to train the users. And you have to decide when you train the users. So why is it a challenge? So what do you think? So put yourself in the shoes of those people. Do you think it's going to be a challenge to decide when to train? Why?
Because at the same time you have to run your business.
Of course, yeah. That's, yes, we'll talk about that. But yes, you have to run your business.
During the most, not during the busy time, but during that season.
That's another good question, when to deploy the system. We'll talk about that on the next stage, system implementation. I will mention the timing of the deployment.
But when training.
But the timing of training is a somewhat different matter. So think about it. If you have to learn a new program, so when do you learn the program? Yeah. No. Okay. Look. What do you think? So if you knew that you had to use Microsoft Access in this class, and you learned Microsoft Access a year ago and didn't touch it since then, what do you think your proficiency with Microsoft Access would be now?
Pretty good.
Good?
Well, better than not.
Or, right? Well, if you don't use it, you lose it, right? So it's, as they call it, it's called a perishable skill, right? So you, if you learn a certain program, you have to start using it more or less, right? Well, if not necessarily right away, then soon. So this seems to indicate that the training of the end users has to be done very close to the timing of the implementation of the system, when the system is going to be put in place, right? So you cannot train your users very far in advance. It's going to be wasted, right? Okay, fine. Then, okay, so let's say you want to train everybody a month before the system goes online. And you have an organization with 100,000 users. So think about the logistics. Can you train all those 100,000 users just a month before the system goes online? Why? Why not? Well, first of all, you're going to have limitations of different types of resources. A simple thing, where are you going to train all those users? You cannot train them at their regular workplaces. They are not set up for that. So how can you get those facilities where you can train them all more or less at the same time? Then, who is going to do this? That's also a very good idea. We'll talk again about that. Yeah, as a matter of fact, not necessarily the managers. There is this concept of a power user and or system champion. And those people are not necessarily managers. It may be a foreman on the shop floor. So keep in mind that we are talking about the systems which are deployed throughout the enterprise. It's not just in the accounting department anymore. It is everywhere. Okay? So you have to find people who actually have respect of their peers, who are curious and capable, and it's not only important that they will help you with later training the other people later, but it is also important that those people will be your first line of defense when the system comes online. Because these systems never come online smoothly. No matter what you do, there will be problems. So what we have to do is to minimize them. But you have to know that the problems will come, and you have to put your plans in place to handle those problems. That's a separate issue. But so with training, you cannot train them too far in advance, and you cannot train all of them right before the system goes online, right? Because it's not feasible. Another one, as you mentioned, they have to do their job. Okay, now you have to train them on this. How do you motivate them? So, can you train them during regular working hours? Well, you would try, but still, they have their day job. You cannot stop the enterprise. Now, it's like, you know, changing the tires on the car that keeps running, right? And I don't know if you watched Formula One, that actually there are ways where people almost look like that, basically what they do. But it's a really tricky business. So you have to find some kind of combination. So there may be certain things that can be done during the hours. There may be certain things that have to be done after the hours. Now, those people actually work full time. They have their family obligations. You know, they're tired. Now you tell them that they have to stay longer because you're going to train them on this new system. And to many of them, it looks nothing like they have ever seen before. Now, how do you motivate them? So how do you motivate them to make sure that they pay attention? Now, yeah.
Probably bonuses. And also telling them that your job is gonna get easier. You're gonna save so much time with this new software coming for.
Good ideas. I wish they were feasible. Bonuses will not work. You're talking about all the enterprise. You are going to blow through the budget of the system doing other things. So you simply don't have the money. As far as their job, I don't know if it's going to get any easier. What you can assure them that their job will be very different. One of the challenges, so when we talk about system implementations, one of the challenges of the introduction of the new system is not just a new system interface, but the way those different tasks are automated and facilitated by computers results in changing job functions. So after the introduction of a new system, quite a few people in the company will be doing certain things they have never done before. So it is not just training in the system, it also involves training in these new job functions. Okay? So this complicates the matter. And if people are tired and you cannot really pay them extra for this, they may not pay attention. You know, I can tell you that even teaching students, I have a lot of levers at my disposal to motivate the students, right? So the students are very interested in getting a good grade, right? So it's very powerful motivation. And I still have challenges, you know, keeping students engaged during the class. So just imagine that those people who come after putting 8 hours of work, and how do you make sure that at least they stay up, that they don't fall asleep, right? Well, different companies experimented with different things. So Microsoft, there is this documented story, when Microsoft was deploying Oracle applications, and actually the accounting part of the system, so they announced to their people that, you know, after this training, so there will be tests, of course, proficiency tests, and if you don't pass it, you're not going to get access credentials to the new system. And if you're not going to get access credentials to the new system, you're not going to be able to do your job, and we'll have to let you go. So that's a rather extreme form, but some companies have practiced that. And I can assure you that that's a very powerful motivation, right? So if you know that you're going to lose your paycheck, so you're going to be paying attention. But again, it's still a challenge because you, no matter how motivated those people are, you train them 6 months in advance, they don't see the new system in 6 months, it comes online, they will have no clue. So you have to do a lot of different things just to make sure that this works. By the way, all this is now is learned through very, very painful experience. There have been quite a few documented cases where early ERP implementations failed because the systems were not properly tested and the users were not properly trained. So the systems were designed perfectly fine. There was no problem with the underlying design of the system. They performed more or less as expected, but because of those things, so the implementations were really, really rough. So again, this is probably the last time you have this chance to do the feasibility analysis to see, okay, so after this development, can we really do this? In some cases, you know, there have been cases where people pulled the plug. Keep in mind that by this stage, a lot of money has already been spent. So if you pull the plug at this stage, so all that goes down the drain. Okay, system implementation. So what's that? Well, this is supposed to be a fairly short stage. By this stage, the system is basically created, tested, the users are trained, right? And you are getting ready to go live, okay? So what do you have to do? Well, first of all, you have to migrate the data. So this is known as data conversion. In the old days, when you implemented computerized systems for the first time, there was a lot of manual data entry because a lot of information existed only in the form of paper documents. And those paper documents had to be keyed into the system. Now, these days, it's extremely uncommon. So these days, when you implement a new system, you already have an older computer system in place. So your information already exists in the computer readable format. And it has to be migrated into this new system. How do you do this? Well, what's the challenge? Well, the challenge is that the form of the data is very different. So in the most typical scenario, you'll have a lot of data in different files, and you will have to load them into databases. where the data has to fit into the data structures that you have developed. Now, it's a non-trivial task. And the way it is done today, people actually write programs to do this. So there are specialized programs which are written just for the sake of this data conversion, where you take the data as it exists and you convert it into the formats which will be able to go in. Now, keep in mind that not everything can go in. For example, in your system, if you didn't have unique identifiers, say for your customers, and you simply try to use some of those numbers which were already created, you code them, and you then try to load all those customers' records into a table, it will not go in. So the system will bounce it off, you will get an error message. So this is what actually happens when you try to do it. So you have to do something about the data to make sure that the data is ready to go in. Okay? So data conversion traditionally presented as this fairly technical step where, you know, programmers write programs for this, you push a button, it goes in. I personally didn't have any experience with this until I started talking about, I would say, 15, 16 years ago. I started talking to people who were running very large scale system implementations for hundreds of thousands of users. And they shared with me how difficult it turned out to execute this step, which was a total surprise to me because never crossed my mind that the primary problem is not the complexity of changing the formats. The primary problem with data conversion is the quality of data in the old system. So we talked in the beginning that the reason to develop these new systems, for example, is to avoid the duplication of data so that there are no data inconsistencies, right? So this is one of the reasons why we want to develop new systems. And then we're talking about taking old data, converting it, and putting it into a new system. Then guess what? So when you look at those old data points, you will actually find a lot of inconsistencies. So it's not in theory, it is actually the case. Now, if you try to convert this data into a format that has to be loaded, you have to resolve those data inconsistencies. So if you have two different phone numbers for a customer, you find one in one file, you find another one in the other file. So your system, your new system is designed in such a way that there is only one field for that phone number. And you have two. Which one are you going to load into the new system? So what do you think? Do you understand the problem? So you have this old data, okay? So you take it, and your program actually has to convert it to this new form. Now, there are different files, so you have different versions of that the same customer's record. In one version, you see one phone number. In another version, you see a different phone number. So in the new system, there will be only one customer's table. In that customer's table, there is a single record for the phone number. There is a single field for the phone number. So which phone number are you going to load into that field? Well, because the system was designed in such a way that they kept duplicate versions of customer information. And God only knows what happened, but this is the end result. You don't know why, so you know what you see, what you find in the files. So you look at the files, you try to create this sanitized record of the customer, okay? And you're facing a choice. I mean, a programmer can create a program to do whatever you want. But what are they supposed to do? So what would be the right thing to do? What would you do?
To check which number is correct.
Okay, how would you do that? I see. Pick up the phone, right? And call both numbers. That's an easy case, by the way, so at least there is a phone. And as a matter of fact, you're absolutely correct. Because there is no additional information that would allow you to determine which one is the correct number. Now, the problem with this is that this is not a program anymore. Okay, so you, in most of those cases, you actually have to get humans to do this. So resolving those data inconsistencies that you find in the system. And you'd better make sure that they do it properly, because there have been cases, and this is another problem with this, that I thought. So not only this, you realize that this is incredibly expensive and time consuming, right? So this is not writing a program anymore that does the number crunching and loads it. So those programs will bounce off a voluminous error log with all those inconsistencies that will have to be resolved manually. Now, that manual resolution of inconsistencies is expensive and time consuming, right? Now, if it is not done properly, that what will happen is that you will get wrong information in your shiny new system. And the worst part about it is that in many cases, that wrong the problem with that wrong information will manifest itself months, if not years later. Okay, I've heard about the problems where, say, incorrect part descriptions were entered. And those were not very common parts. Okay, and only 2 years later, people ran into that, and there were tremendous problems with this. So this is a critical step. And so, you know, you read something, it's a couple of sentences in the textbook. Until you actually run into this and start doing it, only then you start realizing what is involved and how complex it is. Okay? So this is, again, you don't really have much time for this. Okay, you have to mobilize your resources, but this is critical. You have, it's known as, so the step that I'm describing, this resolution of inconsistencies, often is called data cleansing. So basically you have to make sure that you get the correct data elements, otherwise you're going to be having tremendous problems. So then we go to the system switch, system conversion. So what is system conversion? Well, this is literally how you move from the old system to the new system. And there are three approaches to this. One is known as a sudden switch. A popular name in the literature, some people call it cold turkey. That's when you are preparing Thanksgiving turkey, you take it out of the freezer and put it in the oven right away. So that's the analogy. So what is this sudden switch? As the name suggests, so you flip the switch on the new system, flip the new system on, flip the old system off. Okay? Now, you probably realize that this is very risky, right? Why? Because what happens if a new system has a serious problem, right? So the old system is off and the new system cannot do it for you. Again, in the late 1990s, there were some spectacular fiascos that involved this sudden switch system conversion. You all know about the company called Hershey, right? I assume many of you like their products. I have to confess, I'm also one of the admirers. In the second half of 1990s, they decided to implement, I believe it was a CDR thing. Now, and they decided to go this, take this route, this sudden switch approach. There were a number of reasons for that, so they were under time pressure. The most common reason why people use sudden switch approach is because it is the fastest. It is the fastest, and therefore, overall, it is usually the cheapest, if you can pull it off, okay? So they thought they had to do that. Now, not only that was extremely risky, in their infinite wisdom, I believe that they decided to do it sometime around early August. So you know what kind of business they're in. So this company, Hershey, what do you think? What kind of orders they were taking, say, in late July, early August? Yeah. So that's the time when they were taking their Halloween orders. So it so happens that for this company, it's probably 40, if not 50% of their business. Okay. They switched the new system on, switched the old system off, and the system was barely moving. It was almost paralyzed. So there were serious problems with the system, and they couldn't use it. So it was a total fiasco because they couldn't switch the old system back on. They had to take the orders on paper. So Hershey was forced in the second half of the 1990s to start taking customers' orders on paper because there was no other fallback position. So they lost tremendous amounts of money. They actually sued the contractor who was doing the implementation. So that was, it was, by the way, very bad publicity for SAP. Was on the front pages of our professional magazines. So it was a total catastrophe. What is interesting is that about 7 or 8 months later, they actually fixed all the problems. They trained the users, they went live, SAP worked fine, so everything worked out. So of course it was very painful and very expensive, but they made it happen. So what is also interesting is that, you know, as I mentioned before, that there were no front page articles about this tremendous success of this ERP implementation. So when it blew up, so it was on the front pages. When 7 or 8 months later they actually fixed it and everything worked fine, it wasn't. There were some short articles, you know, page 43 or something like that. So if you look carefully, you'll find it. It was published, it was no secret. But, you know, this is how it usually happens. So this is... this is the problem with sudden switch. So therefore, people usually try not to go this route these days, if they don't have to. By the way, another one, in the late 1990s, depending on when they did implementations, in some cases they had to do this sudden switch because of Y2K. They were simply under time pressure. There was no time for anything else. And they said, if you can pull it off, this is the fastest. So what are the alternatives? Well, another one is the so-called parallel conversion. Again, as the name suggests, it means you flip the new one on, and the old one is still on, okay? Well, this sounds perfectly safe, right? But keep in mind that if you go this route, when the new system is on, you are basically doing the same work twice, right? So you are entering it in the new system, you are entering it in the old system. Not only you are doing the same work twice, which makes it tremendously expensive, it also makes it very confusing because those systems have different interfaces and their structure is very different. Just keep in mind how you do one thing in one system and then you turn around and have to do enter the same information but using very, very different system. So that's for this reason, this is not something that people do often. So this is usually done where your tolerance for risk is close to zero. It means that, if the system doesn't work, the consequences are so catastrophic that you don't have any other choice. So for example, you implemented a new system in the nuclear power plant, right? So if you're implementing a new system in the nuclear power plant, yes, you are gonna do parallel conversion, right? So because, God forbid, you cannot live with any other consequence. It has to be a success, right? So nothing else is not acceptable. Again, so not very common. So what is very common? A phased-in implementation. So what is a phased-in implementation? So you are trying to implement a new system in a piecemeal fashion. You are trying to take a part, implement that, hopefully succeed, or maybe learn some lessons, and then move to the other parts of the system. how can you do? What are the pieces? How do you do this piece? There are two different approaches. One is to go by functionality. So those systems have different functional modules. And you may decide to start with implementing one. I can tell you that in many cases, when people face this choice, one of the very first modules which is typically implemented is procurement. And the reason for that is that procurement in most places is fairly standard. So if you look at how different companies go about getting the stuff that they need, you know, say getting requests, requisition requests, deciding what you need, getting out requests for proposals, getting pricing information from the vendors, evaluating the vendors, deciding who to get it from, preparing the purchase order, authorizing that purchase order, getting the purchase order out, getting the goods in, you know. Well, this is fairly standard. And this makes it easier to implement, because this stuff is more or less implemented in the same way. And it's, by the way, it's not surprising that when we at Rutgers started implementing this new Oracle-based system, that the first module that went online was procurement. Okay, it's a very, very, very common approach. Then you probably can do general ledger in some. Then you, if you're a manufacturing business, you're dependent on manufacturing. Can be very tricky because manufacturing, there are many different forms of manufacturing. They need different programmatic support. But again, the idea is that by the time that you move on to the following modules, you already have experience. So your team has experience. You're familiar with the quirks of the system. It's easier for you to deal. So this is this is one approach of partitioning the system. By functionality. Another approach is, you can call it geographic or structural. So in a large organization, you typically have different parts, different divisions, different locations, and you may decide to implement the new system one division or one location at a time, if it is possible. And again, with the same idea, you are limiting your risk. So you want to make sure that, okay, you, if something doesn't go as planned, at the very least, that the exposure is limited. Okay? And by the way, you can combine the two. You can go one location and one module at a time. So that, depending on how big your organization is. So that's also possible. What's the problem? Well, this sounds reasonable, right? So common sense tells you that it's probably a good way to limit your risk. So are there any problems? As always, you know, there is no free lunch. So what's the problem? The problem is temporary interfaces. So when you're switching a part of your organization, either by functionality or by structure, to a new system, necessarily the other parts are on the old system. And the question is that how do you actually put those two things together? So when the whole system is implemented, it is designed as an integrated system, so all those parts should be working seamlessly with each other. But what happens in the interim? And it's a challenge, and it costs some additional resources because you have to create those temporary interfaces. And those temporary interfaces are necessarily not of the same quality as what you do for the long term, right? So this is where the problems may be. And that's why some people say that, you know, this inflicts its own kind of pain. And that's why people also think that this may not be, in some cases, this may not be the best approach. And another tendency is because you know that, you know, you're not doing the whole thing right away. The project can drag on and on and on. So you may implement a part of the system. And then you think that you will move on to the next module. But you don't know what happens in the meantime. And it may be you're out of money. So you want to implement the next module and there is no budget. OK? okay, and you're getting stuck for a few. We actually were a kind of situation like that, so you can end up in this situation again. So you thought that all those temporary interfaces were there just for 3 months, and it turns out that you'll be using them for 3 years as a result of this. So and the top management may lose focus. So all that presents challenges. So there is no universally correct answer, and it has to be adapted to the situation. So whether you go the sudden switch approach, you go parallel, or you go phased. Any questions about this? Okay. Documentation. So I talked about this before. So this is the final chance. So the system has to come with properly developed documentation so that the system can be properly operated and maintained and improved. And this includes both user manuals, technical manuals, troubleshooting manuals. The code has to be self-documented with comments in the code. I talked before how challenging this is. So this is the final chance when this documentation has to be finished. Questions? Okay, so we are done with the system implementations. Finally, the system operation and maintenance. So you flip the switch, you are operating a new system, then what? Well, even if you do your best and you're very comfortable, there is still a very high chance that there will be problems. So therefore, on the day when this happens, your troops have to be ready. So this is your D-Day. Okay, so this is when things happen, and you have to be ready to respond. It is critical to choose the right time. So usually you choose the slowest time. So for example, 4th of July weekend. In many companies, a very popular time for implementing a new system. Business is slow, not much is happening, perfect time. So you have to deploy this rapid response team, so to speak, because there will be problems right away. So you flip the switch, certain things start breaking. Okay? So you have to have a help desk ready at operational. Everybody has to know how to get in touch with them. You have to have those super users or power users deployed throughout the organization, because you know, even today, after you know so many years of experience with computers, I still see, so when people start using a new system, you train them, they get into a situation that they didn't expect to see, and they freeze. So it's this deer in the headlights moment. So they're totally paralyzed, they don't know what to do next. And this is the time when you need to provide help. If you don't, then the system will not work properly. So this is this critical period. Usually it is short. It's known as the period of corrective maintenance. So certain bugs will come up, those that you didn't detect during testing, no matter how good your testing is. And you have to be ready to fix it fast. So this is a very intense period, high stress period. The good thing is, usually it is over fast. So this period usually doesn't, if you have done your job properly. So this period will be over soon. How soon? Maybe a week or two. So if you do it properly. And another good thing is that you don't really have to go out and search for problems. Those problems will find you. So people will come to you because the system breaks and things don't work. So after this first period is over, when all those obvious bugs are fixed, bless you. So what comes next is what is known as perfective maintenance. So this is a much longer period, and the problem is much more subtle. Why? Because at this stage, it doesn't look like the system breaks. It doesn't look that, you know, certain transactions are frozen, don't go through. So the system seems to be functioning. But there are certain things that don't work quite as well as they should. That certain things become awkward, that your users find it very difficult to do. Certain transactions take longer than expected. Okay, and so this is the time when you have to identify the problems and fix them. And the identification at this stage is not simple. It is not obvious where the problems are. So what people do, they do these extensive studies. Systems like this maintain log files where all the information is logged carefully. A very popular technique at this stage of preventive maintenance is the examination of the log files. Because, you know, if you study carefully those log files, you may uncover where the slowdowns are and where those problems really are that have to be fixed. And hopefully, so this may take several months, the very least. And then there is this ongoing operation of the system, which will require regular patches, maintenance, and other things. But by the time you are done with perfective maintenance, basically you have a properly operating system deployed in the organization. Your end users know how to use it. It doesn't mean that that's it, you can sit back and relax, but it means that, okay, so you are in the stage of this normal system operation. So it is also customary after the end of the project to do this post-mortem analysis, as they often call it. So to see what went wrong and what went right. So where the problems were and what kind of lessons you can learn from this experience so that the next time you can do it better. And this includes this formal development life cycle that we discussed up to now. Questions? Okay. So this is this basic description of the system development life cycle. Now, the rest of the chapter deals with various tools and techniques that can that are used these days to manage such projects better. And this is actually this whole new area of project management. There are even programs designed for that. So even Microsoft had a program called Microsoft Project. Most ERP systems have project management features built into the systems themselves. So you can set up projects in SAP and track projects in SAP. So these days, it is a really well computerized problem. Formal study of projects and how to execute projects dates back to the days of the Second World War. And the reason why people had to deal with that at that time was because by the time of the, you know, the first industrialized war was the First World War. But the First World War, particularly in the West, was more or less stationary. So it was what people call trench warfare, right? So there was this very fast period of initial hostilities, you know, and then the front line more or less stabilized on the Western Front. And the movements were, I don't know, a couple of miles forward, a couple of miles back. So therefore, the demands of industrialized warfare didn't really challenge significantly the existing logistics. The Second World War was very different. By the time of the Second World War, you know, they have already mechanized infantry that moved much faster. So in most cases, the action was much more dynamic. And logistics became this critical aspect, that how actually you move a lot of resources, how from one place to another, so what do you have to do, how do you run the projects. Then the development of new weapon systems was also viewed as a project. So this was the early days of what became later on as operations management. I think that you actually have to take a class in operations management. It's a required class, right? I don't know if you have already taken it. So what we mentioned here, I believe, is covered in much more details in that class, operations management. We cover it because, again, it is important to this part that when people develop new information systems, they have to use project management techniques, which originated in the 1940s during the Second World War, just to support this. And after the war, you know that the project became only more complex. So the first technique is known under two different names, PERT CPM. PERT stands for Project Evaluation Review Technique, and CPM stands for the Critical Path Method. There are actually two equivalent formulations of this technique. So what you see, again, I assume that it is covered in your operations management class. What you see on this slide is actually the CPM version. It's not the PERT version. In both cases, you model your project as a set of interrelated activities, okay? And you want to analyze the project to figure out how long it takes and what the problem, what the critical issues are in the project using formal graphical models, okay? And in both cases, you use nodes and arcs, but in one case, you represent your activities in nodes, in the other case, you represent your activities in arcs. So in this case, this is a CPM formulation. When you model your project in this way, you represent it as a graph. And in this graph, the nodes of the graph are the activities of the project. The nodes are connected by directed arcs, and those directed arcs represent the so-called precedence relationships between activities. By the way, does anybody remember this? So I assume that if you have taken operations management, you have heard this story before. Can anybody raise your hand who remembers this? Okay. You're taking it now. You didn't get to that yet. You will, I'm sure you will. Because it's one of the standard features. So basically, here you see an example of activities from the system development lifecycle. So they say, okay, so let's take system development lifecycle that we just covered as an example. Let's take some of the activities in the system development lifecycle, represent them as nodes. So what are the activities? One is requirements analysis, right? So this is node one. Then we have system survey. This is node two. Then feasibility analysis, node three, right? Logical data and process modeling, node 4, right? And model integration, node 5. Okay? So a set of activities from the system analysis stage, right? And system design stage. Right? Some activities are taken from the system analysis stage, some activities are taken from the design stage. So those are the nodes. So what is the significance of the directed arcs? As I said, they represent precedence relationships. What does it mean? Well, there is a directed arc going from 1 to 2. So what does it tell us? It tells us that we cannot start system survey until we complete requirements analysis. Okay? So there is a precedence relationship between activity 1 and activity 2. And it expresses the fact that we cannot start working on system survey until the requirements analysis is completed. Is that clear? Okay. So there is an arc from 1 to 3 which says, again, we cannot start working on feasibility analysis until requirements analysis is completed. Right. Great. Pay attention to the fact that there is no directed arc from 2 to 3. Right. There is from 1 to 2, from 1 to 3. There is no directed arc from 2 to 3. What does it tell us? That there is no precedence constraint. It means that 2 and 3 can run at the same time. So they're done by different people. So as soon as you complete the requirements analysis, you can start activity two, you can do system survey, and you can start activity three, you can do feasibility analysis. Is that clear? Now, if you look at activity four, then you see that there are actually two directed arcs ending at activity four. These two precedence constraints tell you that you can start logical data and process modeling only when both system survey is completed and feasibility analysis is completed. Okay? So three and four must be finished before you can start four. I'm sorry, three and two. Three and two must be finished before you can start activity four. Okay? So what else do you see on this diagram? Well, you see that there are certain numbers in parentheses next to the names of the activities. So what is the significance of those numbers in parentheses? They tell you how long it takes. So this is the duration of those activities. And in this case, you can think of it as days. It can be weeks, whatever. But the unit of measurement is not relevant. So in a certain unit of measurement, it takes 3 units to conduct system survey, right? But it takes only 1 unit to conduct feasibility analysis. Well, let's say it takes weeks. Let's say unit of measurement. So one of the questions that you can answer using a model like this is the determination of the minimum duration of the project. So let's say that those activities are measured, the duration of those activities is measured in weeks. So can you tell me how long this project will take? So what is the minimum duration of this project? How did you get it? Speak up. So you add up the duration of requirement analysis, which is 2, right? Plus 3, which is 5, right? Very good. So plus 6 for the logical data process model. Model integration, another 3 weeks, right? 2 plus 3 is 5, plus 6 is 11, plus 3 is 14. Very good. So this is, and it seems to be reasonable, right? So what you did, you calculated the length of the duration of the longest path. And this is what this critical path method is all about. You trace all different routes from the beginning of the project to the end of the project. And for every route going, directed route, going from the beginning to the end, you add up the duration of activities along that route. So let me say it again. So when you do this critical path method, so in this case it was obvious to you that you could just ignore activity 3. It is not that obvious in many cases. So therefore what you have to do, you have to examine how you can get from start to finish in all possible ways. And for every route, you calculate the duration of the route. And then you take the longest duration. So in this case, you would compare 14 and 12. And you would say that 14 is longer than 12. And therefore, the duration of this project is 14 weeks. Okay? So this is what the critical path method is. It says that, you know, when you create this project graph and you calculate all the paths from start to finish, then the longest duration of the path is the minimum duration of the project. Why is that? Well, because this is what it takes on this path, right? and you cannot do it any shorter because all these activities are in a sequence, right? So you have to spend a week, 2 weeks doing requirements analysis. Only then you can start doing system survey, the 3 more weeks, right? Only then you can start doing logical process, data and process model. Only then another 6 weeks. Only then you can start doing integration. That's another 3 weeks, okay? So great. So what else does it tell us? Well, it tells us that those activities which are on the longest paths are critical. In what sense? Why is it called critical path method? And what is critical about those activities? By the way, in the case of this graph, there is only one activity which is not on the critical path, which is feasibility analysis, right? All the other activities are on the critical path. So what makes them critical? So if an activity is on a critical path, it is critical in the sense that well, then none of them can be omitted. So we assume that whatever you have, whatever notes you have, they all have to be accomplished. No, it's not about that. But those activities are critical because any delay in any of the activities on the critical path will result in what? In delaying the whole project. Okay, so those are our estimates of duration. If any activity on the critical path takes longer than estimated, then the whole project is delayed accordingly. So, in other words, when you will study in operations management, they will say that those activities have no slack, that the slack of those activities is zero. In contrast to that, if you look at feasibility analysis, so you start doing feasibility analysis as soon as you can, how much can you delay feasibility analysis without delaying the whole project? By 2 weeks, right? So the slack on activity 3 is actually 2. So this is the so-called slack time, okay? Now, this is very important for you to know when you manage the project. So you will know that certain activities are critical. You have to pay close attention. There is no slack there. Any slip off, that's it. It pushes the whole project further, right? And there are some activities which are not. Now, this is one consideration, so to know about those critical activities. Another one. So if you think about it, you look at the duration of activities. How can you affect the duration of activities? So in many of those cases, and again, it may contradict, but depending on what you do. So it depends on the allocation of resources. It may be manpower, it may be computing power, it may be some other kinds of resources. But a certain activity will take a certain amount of time given the amount of resources you allocate to that activity. Okay? So if you have only a total limit on the resources available, then knowing what activities are critical and what activities are not, knowing their slack time, opens up the possibility for you to do what? To reallocate your resources from non-critical activities to critical activities. Why? Look, they say, here we see that we do feasibility analysis in 1 week. Why can we do it so fast? Well, probably because we have a lot of people doing this, right? Maybe, it's not a sure thing, but maybe we can reallocate some of those resources from feasibility analysis to system survey. So if we reallocate some of those resources from feasibility analysis to system service, so our total resources, our total resource consumption doesn't change, right? But it may result in reducing the duration of system survey by one unit while increasing the duration of feasibility analysis by one unit, right? So if we can do that, what will be the end result? Correct. So by simply reallocating our resources without consuming any more resources, we can finish this project a week earlier. We can do it in 13 weeks instead of 14. Is that clear? Again, this is just a very, very brief introduction. You will study this more, but this is basically the idea. Okay? So this is the idea of what is known as this critical path method. Okay? Used routinely, supported in all project software, project management software, a standard feature. So what is not so convenient in this project model? So this particular project model, while it is very good at determining what the critical activities are, does not make it easy for us to track the progress of individual activities. So it is easy here to keep marking activities as completed. So if we use, say, a critical path method, then we can track the progress of the whole project in terms of completed activities. So this is easy because we can say add color to the nodes or start shading the nodes that have already been completed, right? So what it doesn't allow us to do, it doesn't allow us to track partial progress of individual activities. Why not? Because an activity here is a point, right? It's a dot, it's a node, right? We can either mark it as completed, or if it's not, it's considered not completed yet. What if we're 60 or 70% through this activity, and we want to know that? Do you understand what I'm after? Then this tool is not particularly convenient for that. Okay? There are other tools, an old and popular one is known as the so-called Gantt chart. So what is a Gantt chart? A Gantt chart is a representation of activities of the project that uses intervals. Okay? Instead of using nodes, instead of using points, dots, to represent activities, we're going to use intervals. And if we use intervals, and the length of the interval corresponds to the duration of the project. Okay, so we represent them horizontal. Okay, so these are the activities of the project. We also can utilize directed arcs to represent precedence constraints. But now this is gonna be, it looks more complicated than the previous one, right? Because not only you have precedence constraints, but you have those intervals. So therefore, if you are just interested in the total duration of the project, it is easier just to use the critical path method. But if you want to keep track of the progress of individual activities, this is better, because the partial shading on the intervals will allow you to indicate which percentage of activity has been completed so far. And again, you can graphically keep track of what is going on. Any questions about this? Okay. And what I want to emphasize, that these techniques are not either or. That project management software gives you access to all these tools. So typically people use them all. Okay, so what are the problems with the system development lifecycle? Well, the most common complaint was that it took too long. That this very structured technique in particular the feedback loops, resulted in people going back and forth and just they people on some calling it death by analysis. That you start doing it and just the whole project just again takes too long. That was the idea, was to speed it up and to keep control of it, but it may get out of hand. So people started talking about modifying this approach with the idea of speeding it up and improving the results. Well, one standard way, and we always resort to it these days, is automation. So when, if you want people to actually do things faster, better, more consistently, you want to automate their tasks. And there is a lot of automation software that has been developed to facilitate these tasks. So people call it computer-assisted software engineering. So basically, you use programs to write programs. When I started programming, I wrote my program, I mean, almost 40 years ago, I wrote my programs on paper and then simply typed them in. These days, nobody does it anymore. I don't know anybody. So everybody uses integrated development environments with various features. So this computer-assisted software engineering is routine. I mean, there may be different features which are present in some cases, not in other places, but basically a program gives you some workplace where you work with your things. You also can utilize different tools from a toolkit. For example, there are standard tools that allow you to draw entity relationship diagrams. Data flow diagrams. You can store whatever you created in the repository so it can be reused later on. People often integrate it with the tools that are used to develop the system. So for example, when you create an empty relationship diagram, you can have a program in this toolkit which will convert it into a database. So we will discuss it manually and you will have to do it manually. But there are tools that automate those things, okay? So this automation, of course, helps. But it is not a panacea. So you still have to do other things. So what else do you have to do to speed up this process? Well, there were a number of approaches, number of different approaches proposed. People started talking about rapid application development. So what is rapid application development? Well, I presented system development lifecycle sequential, but as the example of the critical path method showed, it is not a linear precedence relationship. It's not like everything has to be done exactly in the sequence as it was presented here. So there are certain things that simply can be done in parallel. And in some cases, you can even get away with violating a little bit some of the precedence relationships. So what do I mean by this? Let's say that you know you have to complete feasibility analysis of the system analysis stage before you start logical data in process modeling, right? But if you have a basic idea that probably it is going to work out, and you already have completed the requirements analysis and system survey, so you have already a pretty good idea about the data models that you have to create, you can start creating them. So basically, even though there is a precedence relationship there, you can say, you know what, I'm going to relax. In the interest of time, I'm going to assume that this is feasible, and I will start working on designing those models. If it turns out that I'm wrong, I wasted my effort, right? But if I'm right, then the decision will be that it is feasible. I actually, what I managed to do, I managed to get a head start, right? I started doing it earlier than it was anticipated. So this is the idea of rapid application development. So when you try doing this, it will force you, in some cases, to go back and forth, But people argue that in some cases it actually can speed up the whole project. Another thing is this joint application development. People realize that a lot of problems in the project stem from the fact that the end users got involved too late. So if you just follow the steps that we discussed, you involve a very large number of end users by the time that you get to the testing and training stages. This is when a lot of users are introduced to the system you're developing. And people argue that by then, that's it. The horse is out of the barn, so to speak. You cannot really do much about it. So you have to push it early. So you have to involve end users much, much earlier. And the most popular approach for that is known as prototype. So what is prototype? This is an approach where you emphasize the creation of end user interfaces. So you prioritize that before actually implementing detailed functionality. So people also call it occasionally markups. So what is it? It's going to be computer screens that show the end users what the interface is. But in the beginning, they will not be functional. So basically, you have to click certain things, and those clicks don't work. Or they will show you the next screen, but not based on the clicks that you did, but on a certain limited selection. Okay? Just to give you an idea how it works. So when you create a prototype, you solicit the feedback of a large number of users, as many users as possible, with the idea that you can modify what you're doing based on this early feedback, whether it is acceptable or not acceptable. Now, as you keep moving along, so what you're doing, you're not only redesigning the interface, but you are implementing more and more functionality. So this mockup gradually becomes more and more functional. So if in the previous version of the prototype a certain button didn't work, you just show it, but you click it, and nothing happens, then in the next version of prototype, it starts working. Okay? So this is the idea of prototype. In the extreme case, you just evolve this prototype into a fully functional system. Okay? So this is the idea of a prototype. Any questions about this? This is widely used these days. Prototyping is commonly used. It may not be used for the whole system, but pretty much every project relies on prototyping. Okay. Now, another remark that I wanted to mention is that these days, people usually don't program systems from scratch. So system implementations are based on packaged software. So therefore, certain accommodations have to be made, and there are some additional steps that you have to do when you actually work on packaged software. So this is a very fragmented market. So what is unique about this? You know that when people think about computer software, end users. So to the end user, it really looks like either a monopoly or a duopoly. So if you look at personal computers, like it looks like a duopoly, right? Where say Microsoft Windows represents 90% of the market, and OS X, Apple OS, right? Represents about 10% of the market, right? And something to that extent, maybe 80-20 with the smartphones, right? So if you look at the productivity software, so office applications like word processing, spreadsheets, right? PowerPoint, this looks like a monopoly to you, right? Is there anybody who is using anything but Microsoft Office? So to prepare documents, have you ever seen anybody who used something else, not Microsoft Word? Well, you use Paint. Well, yeah, so maybe it's also kind of... As a matter of fact, you know, there is something called OpenOffice. So there are alternatives. But to most people, I mean, it's just this thing. So this is nothing like this. Totally nothing. So we're not talking a monopoly, we're not talking a duopoly. We're talking about a highly fragmented market. So this is the market where, depending on the segment, your biggest player in terms of the software packages may represent like 30-35% of the market. It means that the next one is 20, the one after that is 10, and then you have this long tail of different software packages. So it's a fairly challenging task. It's, there are a lot of different package software in the area of applications, and you have to choose properly. So among the mid-range packages, Microsoft actually is a very strong player. There is something called Microsoft Dynamics, which they bought it a long time ago. There was one of the very successful accounting packages in the late 80s, early 90s, was called Great Plains Accounting. That Great Plains Accounting evolved into Great Plains Dynamics, and then Great Plains was bought by Microsoft. It became a division of Microsoft. So now they have the whole suite of mid-tier ERP systems that they call Microsoft Dynamics. Great Plains is still one of them. So Dynamics GP is the successor of that original Great Plains software. There is Dynamics NV, which is a mid-tier European ERP package that they acquired from Navision. Then there are high-end packages, which is SAP and Oracle primarily. So those are the two main competitors these days. So there is this challenge how to pick a package. And when you do this, you have to look at additional factors that we didn't discuss here. You have to compare the features. You have to identify what we call functionality gaps. Well, different packages will have different functionality gaps. And depending on your needs, you will prefer one over another. You will look at the support options. By the way, support is critical. What people also don't, say you want to buy Microsoft software. To you, the price is the determining factor. Now, with ERP, very often, annual support fee may be 20% of the purchase price. Okay? Just imagine if you had to pay 20% of the price of your house every year to support that house. So support is critically important. Of course, quality of vendor, you have to know how to collect this information. Then people, you know, the book mentions, how do you put all those things together? People usually assign weights to different aspects and have this vendor selection matrix where different vendors are evaluated on the different categories. They assign different scores and you get a weighted sum. And you see who actually comes on top. But it's a complicated process. You come, you call, if it is a big deal, large scale project, you call vendor teams on site. They will do presentations, you will interrogate and get additional information. So all this is involved in selecting the project. But otherwise, the system development life cycle is exactly the same. So there is no difference.